Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship at First Baptist Church of Front Royal. It is a joy to see you here on this beautiful Sunday morning. Both those who are here in our sanctuary and those who are worshiping from home or from vacation somewhere, we are glad that you have joined us. I was glad when they said unto me, "Let us go to the house of the Lord." So today we gather to worship our God who has given us so many good gifts. So now, as we worship, let us focus our hearts and our minds on the worship of our God. Let us worship together.
Thank you.
you now to open your worship guide as we read responsibly our call to worship today, taken from Psalms 100. Make a joyful noise to God, all the earth.
Serve God with gladness. Enter into God's presence with a joyful song.
Know that the Lord is God. The Lord made us, and we belong to the Creator.
We are God's people and the sheep of God's pasture.
Enter God's gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise.
Give thanks to God. Bless God's name. For God is good. God's steadfast love endures forever. And God's faithfulness to all generations.
Pray with me now. O Lord God, as we gather in this place, we gather as one body of brothers and sisters in Christ. Lord, we do give you thanks, and we thank you that we have an opportunity to be in your house. We join together as one. We now ask that you fill us and fill this place with your Spirit as we come this day. Be with us now and accept all those things that are done in your name. For it is in Christ we do pray. Amen. I invite you now to stand as we sing hymn 339, All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name. Please stand as we sing
to invite our children to come down for children's time. begin today by listening to Ms. Karen. She's going to read a scripture passage to us and to the congregation that we're going to talk about. So you'll listen as she reads, okay?
Good morning. I am reading Matthew chapter 25, verses 31 to 46. But when the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, then he will sit upon his glorious throne. All the nations will be gathered in his presence, and he will separate the people as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will place the sheep at his right hand and the goats at his left. Then the king will say to those on his right, "Come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the creation of the world. For I was hungry and you fed me. I was thirsty and you gave me a drink. I was a stranger and you invited me into your home. I was naked and you gave me clothing. I was sick and you cared for me. I was in prison and you visited me." Then these righteous ones will reply, "Lord, when did we ever see you hungry and feed you? Or thirsty and give you something to drink? Or a stranger and show you hospitality? Or naked and give you clothing? When did we ever see you sick or in prison and visit you?" And the king will say, "I tell you the truth. When you did it to one of the least of these, my brothers and sisters, you were doing it to me." Then the king will turn to those on the left and say, "Away with you, you cursed ones, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his demons. For I was hungry and you didn't feed me. I was thirsty and you didn't give me a drink. I was a stranger and you didn't invite me into your home. I was naked and you did not give me clothing. I was sick and in prison and you didn't visit me." Then they will reply, "Lord, when did we ever see you hungry or thirsty, or a stranger, or naked, or sick, or in prison, and not help you?" And he will answer, "I tell you the truth, when you refuse to help the least of these, my brothers and sisters, you are refusing to help me." And they will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous will go into eternal life. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Ms. Karen. First of all, I want to ask a question. So, somebody had a birthday last week. Yes, did you have a good birthday? Yes, and how old are you now? 8, okay. And somebody else had a birthday today? Yes, and how old are you today? 11. Yeah, well, happy birthday to both of you. When's your birthday?
March
3rd. And when's your?
September
8th. Okay, so we have a little bit longer to wait on this birthday. Happy birthday, both of you. Okay, so we heard Ms. Karen read a story that Jesus was telling about separating sheep from goats. Now, I don't know much about goats and sheep. Do any of you know anything about sheep or goats? No? Not much? You know something about sheep?
Goats have horns.
Okay, that's good. All right. Goats have horns. Does sheep have horns? A lamb, maybe? No? Oh, okay. Okay, well, we're really kind of ignorant about sheep and goats. So, anyway, well, yeah, I know. Okay, so the story is actually about separating people by the way they treated others. So, Jesus is praising people who took time to feed others. Did y'all hear that? Feed others, give people water. That's right. Welcome the stranger. And then go visit people when they are in jail. That's right. All of those things. So when we, and what's really interesting about that is when we do all of those things, it's like we're taking care of Jesus. Right? Isn't that crazy? So when we do things to help other people, we are actually doing those things to Jesus. So I wonder how we can do those things if you're young. There's some, you have any ideas of things we can do to take care of other people?
We can join, to help feed some of the homeless people.
That's right. You can help feed the people here. That's right. We do that several times a week here. Anything else y'all can think of?
Raise money for, charities and stuff and help out in the community.
That's right. We absolutely can. And right now, the Salvation Army, they're ringing the bells. Maybe some of y'all have done that. So you could go ring the bell and help raise money. That's a great thing to do. Well, someone once wrote this about a kid, and I thought this was very good, so let me read it to you. The person wrote, "I sat alone in the cafeteria at school, little to eat, and you sat with me and shared your lunch." So that's something we can do too. We can share our food. "Kids laughed at my clothes, but you treated me as if they were name brand. I was never chosen for any sports team, but when it was your turn to choose, you chose me. Everyone laughed at my mistakes, but you said kind words to make me feel better. When I stayed home and thought no one would miss me, but you called and asked me when I would come back. And when you do these things, you do them for Jesus." So those are some ideas of some things that we can do to show others that we love them and we can care for them. So we can all try this week to care for others. Can you please pray with me? Dear God, we love you. Help us to care for others. And when we do that, we're caring for you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you. You can go back to your seats.
Let us now stand as we sing hymn 158, "Jesus Shall Reign." Please stand.
years to come. How often have we spoken and sung those words this past year? And now here we are on the doorway of hope, one Sunday away from the beginning of the season of Advent, looking forward to what is to come with hope, and looking back over our shoulders to see where we have come this year. This one thing we know, O God, that wherever the months have taken us over the last year, your hands have never let us go. You have been with us through it all, through the thick and the thin, the good and the bad. So we come to you today in a spirit of thanksgiving for the consistency of your care. You have moved us through the seasons of this year, from the darkness of Advent to the glimmering lights of Christmas, from the despair in our spirits at the crucifixion of Jesus to the signs of resurrection in our lives and in Jesus' life, from the blustery winter winds to the flurry of summer activities, from the breezes of spring to the rushing wind of Pentecost, you have been there through it all. When we have been full of questions and doubts, you are with us in our confusion, and we give you thanks. When the ground on which we were living began to shake like never before, you are with us in our fear, and we give you thanks. When we didn't have a map for where we were going, you were with us in our dreams, and we give you thanks. With holy discernment, you have guided us to the edge of the future. Now may we grasp the hem of Advent, Christmas, and a new year with faith born of all that we have learned from you in the past. O God, our help in ages past, our hope for years to come. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
So thank you so much for all that you do for us.
So I would like to welcome these folks who are worshiping from home and afar. Nancy Thompson, Susan McIntyre, Rebecca and Camden Webster, Bill and Betty Long, Kathy Ann Stoner, Kathy Sokolukas, and Allison Ringer. We're so glad that you all have joined us this day. So I'll be reading today from the book of Ephesians, chapter 1, verses 15 to 23. I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love toward all the saints. And for this reason, I do not cease to give thanks for you as I remember you in my prayers. I pray that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you a spirit of wisdom and revelation as you come to know him, so that with the eyes of your heart enlightened, you may know what it is the hope to which he has called you, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance among the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of his power for us who believe, according to the working of his great power. God put this power to work in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places, far above the rule and authority and power and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the age to come. And he has put all things under his feet and has made him the head over all things for the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. Will you please pray with me? Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, for you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. When I was a kid, the indoor pool where my brother Jason and I took swimming lessons had a high dive. It was very, very high. Now, swimming lessons usually lasted 2 weeks, and at the end of the first week of swimming lessons, if you could somewhat swim, they would let you go jump off the low dive and then jump off the high dive. I don't know about you all, but if you've ever done that, but I remember being terrified of that high dive. It is a long way down to the water. But everyone else was doing it. So why not? I did too. I jumped off that high dive. And it was terrifying, but it was also fun. So we did it over and over again, jumping in over and over. So today our sermon is entitled, Jumping In. So today is the Reign of Christ Sunday, or Christ the King Sunday, which happens to be the last Sunday of the Christian year. Next Sunday is the first Sunday of Advent, which begins the Christian New Year. So today is New Year's Eve. So happy New Year's Eve to all of you. So this day, the Reign of Christ Sunday, was first celebrated in 1925. If you remember what was going on during that time in our history, the world was still reeling from World War I, and there were dictators that were laying the foundation for World War II. In Europe and in Mexico, nationalism was beginning to take over, especially in countries like Italy, where Mussolini was championing fascism. So Reign of Christ Sunday was created to remind everyone that Christ now reigns supreme, not the dictators who were fascist. In so many ways, Christ reigned one of peace, love, grace, acceptance, and inclusion, was the opposite of what was being championed in Europe and beyond during those days. And then today, while we may catch glimpses of Christ's reign on earth,
I think that we are pretty far from fully recognizing Jesus Christ's kingdom come to earth. This passage that I just read uses soaring language to describe Christ's reign. Yet our view of reality of present life pales in comparison to Paul's words. The friction in this text comes from the tension between the all-soaring present tense language of Christ's power and then the ongoing resistance of forces today against Christ's rule. Paul speaks of the rule of Christ as if it is already complete and everything is under Christ's feet. The language of praise and worship piles metaphor upon metaphor to exalt Christ. Christ is raised by God's power from the dead. Christ is exalted and sits at the right hand of God. Christ is above every rule and authority and power. All human powers, all human systems of power, all domination, not only in this age, but also in the age to come, are subject to Christ as sovereign with God. The epitome of this power is that Christ is the head of the church, his body, the new humanity created through him. If you look closely, you'll see that Paul was writing in the present tense. And yet all around him and all around us, we see the opposite of Christ reigning supreme. Paul talks about powers and authorities, meaning a world where forces seem to be out of control and they are wrecking all kinds of havoc in our lives. The list of plagues in our modern world is quite long. If Christ reigned supreme, we would not be feeding people four nights a week in our parking lot because people would have enough food on their own without having to eat here. Also, if Christ reigned supreme, we would not be watching war playing out in two parts of the world right now, in Ukraine and in Israel, Palestine. If Christ reigned supreme, children would not be abused and neglected. Elderly people would not be left to die alone. People would not be struggling with mental illness. The pandemic would not have happened. Racism would not happen. And even inflation would not happen. And honestly, what is even more depressing is that some governments seem complicit with these powers, which are the opposite of Christ's reign. And some governments even profit from them. In Jesus' day, in Paul's day, and still in our day, governments, whether they be kings or queens or emperors or board of supervisor members or town councils or presidents or legislative bodies, they are not Christ's reign on earth. While governments may embody some of the characteristics found in God's idea of heaven come on earth, if we are honest, we all know that they fall short of bringing Christ's reign to earth. The writer of Ephesians, which we assume is Paul, is addressing the political and imperial rulers and cultural practices that sought to demonstrate their power over people in ways that were opposite to the reign of Christ. But Paul is also reminding Christians of God's cosmic victory over death in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. This same power, the power that we see at Easter, is available to all of us who follow Jesus. Our Christian hope is grounded in the cosmic caused by God at the resurrection of Jesus. Jesus' resurrection defied the powers of death and sin for all creation. It is this resurrection power that will ultimately bring about the transformation of our world. And my friends, that's where we come in. We are all citizens of God's society and kingdom. And as citizens of God's society, we all have choices to make about how we live. And our choices about how we live can transform our world or not. You see, there are so many ways to be in this world. Scripture says over and over again that Christ's kingdom challenges the empire. It calls out power that is abusive. But if being a part of Christ's reign is to make any difference in our lives, then we have to live as if Christ's kingdom exists and that our participation in it, our commitment to it, and our dedication to it matters for us and for God and for our world. Caroline Lewis once wrote, "God makes possible God's kingdom in the world regardless of what each of us do individually, but God needs us for the kingdom to be more than it could be without us. God needs us for the kingdom to be more than it could be without us." Therefore, the reign of Christ Sunday is not just about acknowledging it, but participating in it, intentionally and deliberately. It means trusting in the words of Ephesians so that with the eyes of our hearts enlightened, we may know what the hope to which we have been called. The hope to which the writer of Ephesians witnesses gains greater meaning when we reflect on this Sunday in the liturgical year. Remember how I said a few minutes ago that this is the Christian calendar New Year's Eve? Well, normally during New Year's celebrations, we all look back at the year that's gone by and we look forward to the year ahead. And I would say the same can be true today. We have a chance to look back on the past year and imagine where and how and when did Christ's ideal of the world have power in our lives? When did we see Christ's reign coming to earth? And in the same time, we have the opportunity to look forward and see how we can help to make Christ's reign come. So perhaps today we might like to think about some New Year's resolutions. Let's not wait until January, but let's do it now as we begin our new Christian year together. Maybe this could be New Year's Resolution Sunday. We can all look back on God's reign in our lives, and we can imagine how we want to be a part of God's kingdom in the year ahead. Now, usually our New Year's resolutions include things like losing weight, getting more sleep, getting more exercise, writing some more letters, watching less TV, or maybe using social media less. But instead, imagine what our resolutions would be if we say we want to be a part of Christ's reign. These will look very different than our typical resolutions because God calls us to a different path, to a different way of being in the world. At the end of the day, to claim Christ as King, to believe in God's reign, to have a claim, Jesus has a claim on our present and not just our future glory when we are in heaven one day. It matters today. And how we decide to live today matters. Not just for ourselves, and not just for those immediately around us, but for the sake of helping to usher in God's kingdom on earth. Perhaps our resolution should include this. Our New Year's resolution is to strive for how to make the reign of Christ more possible for my neighbor.
Well, how can we make the reign of Christ more possible for our neighbors? So here's just a few thoughts. We could try to be kind, even to the person who gets our hamburger order wrong at Spelunkers. Even to the person, we could be kind to the person who cuts us off in their car and almost makes us run into the back of them. And we can even be kind to that telemarketer who keeps calling us. That's a tough one, isn't it? We can make sure that people we know who are lonely know that they have a friend in us. And when we spend time with them and they tell us the same story over and over and over again, we can listen like it was the first time. And we can make sure that our neighbors have working smoke detectors. We can come here and help serve meals on Wednesday night. And we can be generous in what we put in our offering plate, because those funds, not only do we send others in the community, but they help us to keep our buildings going. Buildings that house dinner together. Buildings that house the Rotary Doc Smith food baskets that will serve 180 families. Buildings that provide loving and nurturing care for 60 children Monday through Friday so that parents can go to work. Buildings that house a Boy Scout troop and the Warren County Rotary Club. Buildings that house a Narcotics Anonymous group. Buildings that house part of the backpack program for E. Wilson Morrison Elementary School. And buildings that house an office for the Shenandoah Baptist Association. We can also reach out to those we know who are suffering. Friends, the possibilities are endless. Many, many ways that we can make the reign of Christ more possible for our neighbors. If each and every one of us realized just how important we are for God's work in the world, what a different start to the new year we would all make. If each of us embodies a Christ reign mentality each and every day, imagine how much impact we can make on our community and beyond. Now, we can always wait until January to start our Christian New Year's resolutions, but imagine what would happen if we started today. How would Advent and Christmas be different? Because then our presence and our preparation for Jesus' birth would actually reflect the reality of Christ's kingdom coming now. Christ's reign will not wait until we are ready to sign up for our New Year's resolutions, or when we are fully prepared and are perfect. It's here and now. The time is now. So let's all jump in together. Let us jump in together, even when it's scary and intimidating, like jumping off the high dive. Christ isn't waiting until we are ready. Christ can't, and we shouldn't wait either. What if we just decided to go ahead and jump in, regardless of knowing the outcome and whether or not our efforts will be successful? We don't know. Let's choose to participate in bringing about the reign of Christ with only the trust that the reign of Christ will happen. What if we jumped in together with Christ as our King? What if we jumped in together? Imagine the big old splash that we can make together. Are you ready to jump? One, two, three, jump! Amen. So in our time of reflection, I encourage you to take a moment and talk with God about your New Year's resolutions and how we might begin this new Christian year together. How might you help to bring in Christ's reign? So take a few moments and talk to God. Most gracious God, who in Jesus of Nazareth showed us an alternative to the kings and queens and empires of history, help us to emulate Jesus' leadership, to love and to seek justice for all people. Help us to recognize the true grandeur and life-changing power based in loving you and all of our neighbors. In Jesus Christ, may we co-create a world ruled not through domination, but in that radical and all-powerful compassion and love. Amen. Our hymn of commitment is hymn number 267, Blessed Be the Tie. I invite you to stand, if you are able, as we sing together, hymn number 267. I'll be down front waiting if anyone would like to make a decision to stay. Let's
thank you.
blessings that you bestow upon us each and every day. So, Lord, as we examine those gifts that you have generously given to us, we ask that in turn we would generously give back to this church and to this service. Lord, we ask that you bless both the gift and those that give. For it's in the name of Christ we do pray. Amen.
Please be seated for just a moment, just a few matters of common concern. The first is that June White's memorial service will be held Wednesday here in our sanctuary at 1 o'clock with a reception following after the service. And thank you to Mary B. for arranging her reception for us. And I'm sure that she is calling some of you, or she will be calling you to help with that afterwards. Also, it is Christmas poinsettia time, so there is an announcement in your worship guide about poinsettias, and you can make a donation in honor or in memory of someone, and then our sanctuary will be beautifully decorated for Christmas Eve. Also, if you look under the announcements, there is a Christmas party next Sunday at 2 o'clock at Marlow Heights Baptist Church. And I hear that the Grinch is going to be there, and also Santa. So, and we will learn about the real meaning of Christmas. So if you would like to come, all ages are invited. The Ministerial Association is sponsoring this Christmas party at 2 o'clock at Marlow Heights. Also, there are several things going on in the life of our church. The first is that we are collecting gifts for our white gift. You can see what we are looking for in the worship guide, and also, we are adopting 4 children in the foster care system for Christmas. So Dee Dee has a list over here of items that we would like people to purchase for the children, or you can call the church office either way. And those gifts are due back on December 15th. So in the past, you all have been so very generous. So thank you so much in advance for your generosity in helping make Christmas very special for some of our local children. Will you? Yes.
Wednesday, we had about 325 people come for the Salvation Army dinner. Yeah. Plus, we had probably 100 people come in to get boxes to go. So we fed about 425 people, plus all of the volunteers. And some of you came in and you saw we were over-volunteered, which was great. But the Salvation Army wanted me to say thank you for all of the turkeys. There were 21 turkeys that had been cooked. There were 14 trays of mashed potatoes, string beans, stuffing, and mac and cheese of each one of those. There were 50-some pies, if you were. You know, there's a need here, and you see it, but one of the things we could do for one day was give somebody something really good to eat. So thanks.
Thank you so much, Sue, for your help with that, and thank you, Reverend Al, for your many, many years of helping to coordinate the Salvation Army Thanksgiving dinner. And truly, it is our honor to be able to host that, because I don't know if any of you have ever been to the Salvation Army building, but their fellowship hall is tiny. So I don't know how on earth they could have fed 425 people out of that little space. So it is our joy to be able to share this beautiful facility we have with those in our community. Will you please stand now for our benediction? It's a benediction that was written many years ago. May God give you the grace to not sell yourself short. Grace to risk something big for something good. Grace to remember that the world is now too dangerous for anything but truth and too small for anything but love. So may God take your minds and think through them. May God take your lips and speak through them. And may God take your hearts and set them on fire. So my friends, let's jump in together. Go in peace. Amen.